Good evening. I do apologize for keeping you waiting. We just had a little bit of a technical glitch. Welcome. Hello. I'm absolutely delighted you can be here this evening. So welcome to the General Society of Mechanics and Tradesmen of the City of New York. The Artisan Lectures are possible with the support from the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs, as well as the generous support of the McQuesten Companies, Peter Pennoyer Architects, and Bauer and Dean Publishers, and the Friends of the Artisan Lecture Series. The General Society was founded in 1785 by the skilled craftsmen of New York City, artisans who represented 22 different trades at that time. These included carpenters, silversmiths, sailors, saddlers, tailors, and many others. Today, this 220-year-old organization continues to serve the people of the City of New York through its educational, cultural, and philanthropic programs, including our tuition-free Mechanics Institute, the General Society Library, of which, of course, you're in now, and our century-old lecture series, of which this year the Artisan Lectures is part of. This space that you're in this evening is the library of the General Society. Founded in 1820, it's one of the second oldest it is the second oldest library in New York City, and it's one of the three remaining circulating libraries. The book and periodical collections of the library span two centuries and are suited to both scholarly research and as well as recreational reading. Its archives date back, in fact, to 1785. And I also want to mention to those of you, particularly those of this might be your first visit, that you will find information on library membership on the back table. So tonight, we gather once more to pay tribute to the art of craftsmanship. The Artisan Lecture Series has committed itself to giving voice to internationally known artisans who will talk about the intricacies of their specialized craft. The mission of the Artisan Lecture Series is to promote the work and the art of skilled craftsmen to insist ensuring their unique knowledge is understood and carried forth for future generations. I'm so pleased to introduce the curator for the Artisan Lecture Series, who's going to be introducing our speaker tonight, Raphael Francois. I would like to introduce to you Camille Weyart.
Thank you, Karen. Good evening. My name is Camille Weyart, and as Karen shared, I organize the Artisan Lecture Series. Just before we dive into tonight's presentation, I want to share with you that our next lecture will be in Tuesday 13th, and speaking will be Thomas Donahue, sculptor, master, restorer, and art director, and I welcome you to take on your seats or at the entrance a calendar of these lectures. And there will be no lectures December due to the holidays and holiday parties. And on that note, speaking of holidays, two great and very affordable gift ideas is a membership to this wonderful library and a pass to the Artisan Lecture Series. So without further ado, I'm so pleased to introduce you to Raphael Francois. For those who have attended lectures in the past with us, this tonight is going to be a little bit different. We're going to conduct it under an interview format. Raphael was born and raised in Europe and is today the incredible executive chef of Le Cirque, which, as many of you know, is situated in the Bloomberg Tower right next to Bloomingdale's. Raphael just arrived in New York shy of 2014, and he is going to share with you tonight his training and experiences that has included incredible stints in prestigious chalets, chateaus, hotels, and star Michelin institutions. Thank you, and enjoy. And last comment, we will have a Q&A session following the presentation, so we invite you to hold your questions afterwards and also join us for a reception with Raphael. Thank you.
Good evening.
So, Raphael, tell us, what first made you interested in pursuing a career as a chef?
So basically, since a child, I remember all the time the smell. It starts all the time from the same things. The smell from my mom and my grandmother when they were cooking. So I remember that when my grandparents, they were still alive, we were all the time organizing big lunch, especially lunch. So big lunch, and my great grandmother was there doing some things. My grandfather was doing, he was actually cooking more than my grandmother, and I was helping them. So every morning I was awake with the smell of that food, and. And basically, I always liked eating properly. Always liked to eat with my family and to have people around me. And basically, when I was questioning myself about making some pocket money when I was a teenager, the first idea was to work in a restaurant during the weekend or after school. And it came from there. So all started from there when I was 16.
When you were 16?
Yeah.
That's so pretty young to start, to already know that you wanted to be a chef.
I didn't know that I wanted to be a chef, but basically when I went to that restaurant, that chef was introduced to me through a friend. And basically because I didn't know how to use a knife. I didn't know how to cook even an egg. I was there actually to clean pots. I was just there to clean plates and to just to make my little money. And one day, so I don't know if it's a chance, if it was my best day or not. But one day, the number two of that kitchen got fired, and basically the chef was on his own, and he was literally in the kitchen, you say in the shit, but he was so, and basically he asked me to help him, and all started from there, and he actually told me, you got some gold finger. I don't know if it's a true, if it was a lie or not, but basically from there he said, "Listen, next time you come, I would like you to help me to cook, and no need to again spend time in cleaning pot and plates." And gosh, I was very happy when he told me that, because cleaning pot was quite difficult, and all started from there. So. At school, I was actually in mathematics and scientific, and because I was working after school to make my little money. I don't know if you say pocket.
Pocket money.
I found that job on that time very exciting, and I really liked the team spirit and also the excitement of a service, because. Some services are really, really intense, and I really liked it. I really enjoyed it because it was a small restaurant, fine dining, but small restaurant, family restaurant, with just the husband and the wife working together, with few people helping them, and it started from there. So starting from, he explained me how to cut a julienne, which is just a stick of vegetable. And step by step, I learned how to make custard cream, tart tatin, and step by step, I really enjoy it. So, I was wondering if if it would have been good for myself to keep doing in general scholarship field. I don't know if you can say that, or actually going to some things that I really enjoy. So I decided to go to a kind of restaurant school. So I did hotel business management. So because I didn't want just to focus on kitchen, I wanted also to understand everything around the business. Because at the end of the day, we think that running a restaurant it's easy, but it's not easy at all. It's quite complicated business because most of the people who got a restaurant, they have to run everything. And especially in France, because you try not to spend too much money, you try to save as much as possible, so you do everything. So I wanted then to follow business and hotel management side of the business. So so I started from there. So school, and then obviously even at school, even if I like a big organization and the management side of the business, I was still really really focused on food, on kitchen side, because my I don't know if I can say my master, but that guy was all the time listening. Was annoying at that time, but he was all the time listening classical music, and he was very very artistic. So his way of cooking was like by feeling. It was not scaling,
pesé. It wasn't heavy, or it wasn't.
It was serious. Not. Yeah, it was not calculating properly every portion. It was more working by feeling, and everything that he was dressing on the plates was also by feeling. So of course, when he was in a bad mood, the plates was not all the time as good as the day prior. But I really enjoyed that part of the job as well. It was the artistic part of being a chef, and that's why still now I'm working by feeling. Even though to my team I make them working in a very very precise way. It means that everything has to be scaled. Makes sense.
Scaled.
Pesé.
Weighed.
Oh yeah, weighed. Sorry. So everything has to be weighed. Every portion has to be the same, and everything. That's what I do in my kitchen organization. However, when I work on my own, I never weighed anything. I never calculate anything. I always do by feeling. But I do that rule only for myself. So sometimes my staff, they say, yeah, chef, but you, I say, yeah, it's me, but you do like this. So because it's a business. So, and because it's a business, you have to make sure that we can reproduce all the time the same in the same way, even if it's not all the time the same, but we try to minimize the mistake, because when you work by feeling, someone from your team doesn't have the same feeling. So basically, that chef was quite difficult to understand at first, but it was a fantastic apprenticeship, yeah. Because I had to understand someone who was not logical, and so. So it was not logical at all, and then after, when I was going to school and I was learning the classic basic French cooking skills rules, and I was still working with him on the side to make my little money, it was even more illogical than at the beginning, because at school they teach you proper rules, so A, B, C, D. And that guy was all the time A, Z. I find he was a mess. But so that's the part, the artistic part of the job. And I'm still in touch with that guy. We are still very, very close. And even if sometimes I still have questions, I get back to him because even if he say, look, now you don't have to ask me anything, but I still share experience with him. And basically, when I finished school,
how long were you in school?
That's a good question. I've been a few years. So from when I was 16, so I jumped right away on the hotel business management school, and then I finished school at 20.
Okay.
Yeah, 20. So 16 to 20. Yeah, it's quite a few years. But then you can also do it in a shorter way, because some they just do kitchen, some they do just front of the house. There are many options on that. And then step by step, at school they teach you also the world of the Michelin star. So in Europe, when we talk about the Michelin star, it's like for people who are really focused on the high level of restaurant, it's like the top knock of that field, because restaurant, there are many kind of restaurants. You can start from the kebab to the Greek to the. There are so many levels, but in Europe, Michelin star, it's still the, what we say, the crème de la crème. And obviously, at school, they say, yeah, you have to start to do your first stage, which was working in a restaurant for free.
In
kitchen. So I choose kitchen. I choose naturally kitchen. And you have to work for free. So then I work at Château du Milor, which was a famous restaurant in Belgium with two Michelin stars. So that was my first experience in a big organization. I mean, when I came there, I couldn't even imagine that we could have so many people in the kitchen. It was, I arrived and I saw three bakers, five pastry chefs, five people in the garde-manger. I mean, it was people all over. And I say, oh my God, how can you put everything together to make one dish, one plate? And that was my first big restaurant. So every detail was very important. Everything that you put on the plates were weight, proper portion, one customer, if they order together the same steak, they got the same quantity, quality, the same quantity of sauce, the same. Everything was precise, very precise. And then that was more the part of management. Of course, it was still artistic. But there were no feeling anymore. The feeling was when you create the plate, but as soon as the plate was created, that's it, we don't touch. It's like this, and it has to be like this until we change the next menu. And that was my, and from there I was sure that I wanted to do that job. And I was sure that I wanted to be on that level of restaurant. And even if I didn't like the discipline on that restaurant, because when you work with many people and you have to put your training as a feeling training, because my chef, his name was Claude Lavallée, was saying, yeah, do. So I was doing things, and all the time when he was trying something, he said, that's good. I say, yeah, perfect. So basically, as a young person, I was thinking, yeah, you are the best. You do the best things. And when I arrive on that big organization, at the end of the day, you are nothing. You are just a piece on a big puzzle. And that's where you learn that you have to be a whole team. And the whole team as a, I'm not saying one person, but as a whole team, you create an atmosphere and a place. And then it was difficult at the beginning. To get that discipline, to be a part of a team, and when you are a part of a team, you have to be a part of many different kind of personality. Interpretation are different from one another, from one person to another. So it was a very good experience, but I knew that I wanted to go to that perfection of food, of the business.
Great, and you've done also many other places before coming to Le Cirque, including La Maison du Bœuf, Hôtel de Crillon, and the Connaught in London. Do you want to share a little bit more what you've learned through this apprenticeship? Because they also contributed to your...
Yeah, they all obviously, I'm going to speak more about the good experience because obviously sometimes you have bad experience as well. That's the way we learn. So La Maison du Bœuf in Brussels. So now that famous restaurant, which was an institution at that time, doesn't exist anymore. Was a famous place in Brussels. I mean, the Château du Milord was a 2 Michelin star famous organization, but was still in the countryside. But then I was going to a major city, Brussels, with many acclaimed restaurants, and that one was one of them, and very known. Many famous chefs came from that restaurant. So the pressure was very, very present. The customers were pretty different because they were not as relaxed as in the countryside. So they wanted everything fast, kind of New York. They wanted everything perfect, quick. So it was a different mentality. So obviously the people were different as well. Was more eclectic, people from all over the place. So that was very interesting as well. So because of that, the influences of food was obvious because we were working with people from India, people from even in Belgium, you have people coming from the Dutch part, from the French side. So it was already different than French, Spanish, Italian. So when we were doing testing for the executive chef, we could feel the influences from different, the origins of the people. And obviously the food was more international because when you are in a main city like Brussels, obviously you need to have more international food because you have more international people, and Brussels is even more international than Paris because you got the European Commission. So that was a very, very big and amazing experience. So it was a Michelin star restaurant, so it means that one of the best restaurants of the country and of the capital. But the volume was like insane. I mean, I couldn't even imagine that in a fine dining restaurant, we could do so much volume of people and to be on the top notch.
How much, when you mean volume, do you have an idea?
I mean,
a range?
Yeah, yeah. At Maison du Bœuf, we were doing minimum 150, 200 covers. And 150, 200 covers when you are in a top fine dining restaurant, that's a very high volume because you have to pay attention to details. And when you have to spend minutes and minutes on one plate and you have to reproduce that plate 150 times, and it's even not the entire meal of the guy because the customer, they take sometimes tasting menu, which is like minimum 6 dish, or they just take starter, main desserts. It's already 3 dish. So 150 customer or 200, it's how many plates? It's like minimum 600 plates. And you have to do it lunch and dinner. So it was my first high volume of food for a high level of restaurants. So the pressure was intense, really high pressure, because at the end of the day, the customer doesn't care if you have 150 covers. He pays, so he wants for what he pays, and plus he's coming because he read the review and he knows that you got 1 or 2 Michelin stars. So what he expects is to get that. So he doesn't mind that behind you are like trying to give your best. So that was my first big experience in a major city where everyone were stressed morning to evening, all the time. I was all the time seeing people stressed. So you become one of them. You become stressed as well. So, and on other hands, yeah, you step by step, you learn how to deal with stress. So,
okay, and fast forwarding to today, you're working now at Le Cirque, owned by the Maccioni family.
Yeah, that's a stress as well. So.
Can you describe your vision for the restaurant and how it blends with the Maccioni vision?
That's a very how to start. That's a stress, definitely. How to say? So basically, Le Cirque, it's an institution for New York. So which we could compare to La Maison du Bœuf in Brussels, which we could compare to Taïwan or Crillon. There are many places like this in Paris. So it's an institution means history. And because you got that history, you got some expectation. But beside that expectation, you have to try to blend in a good way history and contemporary. I mean, today. That's already a stress. And then it's a family business. That's another way to work because it's a proper business was been run by the founder, which is Cyrio Maccioni, which is who is still very very present. And then you have obviously his sons who represent the contemporary time, and then you have the customer who has been faithful to Le Cirque, who has been coming to Le Cirque for years and years, and they expect their food in the way they used to have it. And then there is me, coming from Europe, who want to do also what I like, and working on eggs, trying to make first of all the first part of the job to make sure that we keep our regular customer because they have been faithful and they have been coming to Le Cirque for years and years, so that's legitimate to make what they like. But in another hand, New York, it's a city with such a big energy, and I can even say that I can say that because I spent so many years in Paris and I spent many years in London as well, and now arriving in that big city and thanks to have done in the right way, Brussels, Paris, London, New York, there is a formidable but very powerful energy that you can feel right away when you arrive. And because of that energy, but there are all the time some things going on in New York. There are always new restaurants opening. Everywhere in New York, you can find some things. You can go downtown, east, west, middle, up, upper, Brooklyn. There are now Michelin star restaurants in Queens. So there are so many things going on in New York that you have to make sure that the standard, the food experience attracts still customers. Because when Le Cirque started in New York, it was just a few restaurants. And it was just a few restaurants, and I don't know how to say that, because I don't want to have enemy tonight, but
the competition,
the gastronomy in New York 40 years ago was not as good as now. I mean, now in New York you have so many organic products, you can get everything you, I mean, in New York you got even more than in France. You go to Union Square Market, you are in middle of New York, and you find herbs that you say, wow, what's going on here? But 40 years ago, all those things didn't, maybe I'm wrong, but didn't exist in New York. Mm-hmm. I mean, and now in New York, the food industry is so, it's so booming. So some customers in the past, they were used to have strawberry, tomato, January to August, and because they wanted to have the produce whenever they want. But now we have new customer that they are very involved about food industry, and if you put a tomato on the plate in January, they're gonna say, yeah, but that chef is completely nuts. Why is putting a tomato in January in the plate? But in Anotarens, I have someone who used to have his lobster salad with tomato in January with tomato. So, and that was my first mistake, because when I arrived and I saw a lobster salad, on the plate, it was in January, and I saw that tomato, I say, wow. It's January, it's snowing, and winter was horrible. I mean, the snow was so... I said, oh, can you get a tomato on the plate? So I removed it. And that was my mistake. So when I was... And I love going to the dining room. I love to go to the dining room. But that day, I didn't like that much, because there were many unhappy customers. So I put it back.
What are some of the entrees that you've recently introduced that you'd like to share with us?
So what I did, I kept pretty much 30% of the classic. The classic are all the dish that Le Cirque used to have. So I have currently 30% of the dish on that menu, and then I have 70%. Which are completely new. And on top of that, we have Brasserie on the Side, which is a different restaurant with more comfort food, casual food, more affordable, I would say. So obviously, my dish, they are more linked with the season. Even if the season, it's also a big part of the job, because when you come, and that took me a few months to understand the season in the US. Because in France, season, it's easy. When you don't find on the market, it means that it's out of season. So that's easy. But here is not the case. Here you can, and I didn't realize that. But here you can still have not everything good, but you can still find produce that come from California. And then as a chef, you have to question yourself. You say, am I a seasonal chef in a USA point of view, or am I a seasonal chef in a New York point of view? And I decided to be more in a New York point of view. So seasonality with the produce is to um, is to know the supplier and all the producer that you can have in New York. And that's why I'm very, I'm still amazed about what you can find in the US, is there are so many farmers who are really, and even young people, because in France, being a farmer, I mean, it's like people doesn't want to do that job anymore. And here is the opposite. You see so many young people who really, it's a kind of philosophy for them to do organic food in order to a well-being. So it's like a way of life, because they are even organic on their food, but even on the way they live. I mean, they want to live in a really like the Amish, for example.
Yeah.
No, but that's true, because I'm buying produce from them,
right,
and they do it everything in a way that we don't even do it in France. I mean,
right.
So as a little Belgian French coming in the US, I'm like, wow, yeah, because we don't have we don't have those communities. So that makes my job very interesting, and I guess it will take me a few years before I get to a point I will feel completely comfortable on what I'm doing right now. So yeah, I have 70% of new dish that they are on the menu, in a way to bring that menu more contemporary, in a way, and to keep also some old dish that
classics.
And when I arrived at Le Cirque, my first idea was, and that's why experience is very good, was I'm gonna refurbish all the classic. That was my idea. I'm gonna take all the classic and I'm gonna make them more up to date. And thanks God I did that that lobster salad first, which made me think, don't even try with the paupiettes, don't even try with the flounder, and don't even try with the chicken. So keep it like it is. And I was clever, actually, because that was my best decision at Le Cirque. So basically, we have the classic, and the classic, they are like it used to be. So I didn't change. If someone said to me, yeah, it was not, I said, no, sir, sorry, I didn't touch. I do the same. Even if sometimes I could think that as a chef, it's not done in the way that it should be, but at the end of the day, it has to be good for the customer. Because even if you learn the classic like it should be, one culture, one country to another, the logical is different. So I can't come with my French logical and to say that's the way it should be. And that's why some French chefs, they arrive from France in the US. And they were thinking, yeah, we know, you don't know, and that's the way it should be. But in 2014, it's the opposite. Because the history in France is, in Europe, is a customer go to see a chef for his food. But like in London and in the US, you have to adapt your style to what's going on now. So you have to please the customer. And I'm on that logical. So basically my style, I have my style like I used to have my style in London, but obviously, because I'm not stupid, I adapted my style accordingly to the customer I have, because I don't want that he send me back the pigeon or the beef 10 times because I don't do it the way they like. So because I don't like to do my job many times the same, I adapt myself to the customer I have. And that's also because at school you learn in management, in business, you learn that you have to work with the market you have. And so was difficult, but it was not. So the most complicated things here in New York is to see all those competitors that you have around, and then the critics. Because the critics, they are very sharp. So they can be very, very sharp with you. So sometimes it can be unfair or fair, but you have one person who judge your food, and because of that person, your business can be wealthy or it can go down. So that's also the big difference with Europe. Mm-hmm. Because I read some article with critics, and sometimes the critic they talk about the chef directly. So that's the pressure I have on day to day, because I have to say that I'm very exposed. Mm-hmm. I'm very exposed. You are in a institution, so so it means that you have to make sure that everything runs like it used to be. But then you have a new generation of critics, and they are expecting some things new and some things different. So you have to do some things different in some things that you can't really make too different neither, because you have to keep the spirit and the soul of the restaurant, which is normal. You can't completely change an institution. So that's a pressure. That's my main pressure right now. Because from those critics, you can have an happy customer. And my job is to make sure that my customers are happy. So, it's a daily basis pressure.
And as a chef, what's your favorite thing to do? Because you have many responsibilities, from overseeing the kitchen, the staff, the suppliers.
Yeah.
And do you have one particular thing of everything that you love to do the most?
Yeah, but I'm lucky to have a team, so like this, I don't need to do everything. And what I learn also with all my experiences is to delegate, because if you don't delegate, and if you don't train people to be able to trust and to be able to delegate, but I won't be able to be here. So, yeah. So I like eating, obviously. And I do eat a lot, but obviously I love going. I hope that's not going to be boring to say that, but I love going to the restaurants. I mean, obviously when I am home, when I am on day off, I like not to cook. I like just being on the table and being served, and I don't complain. And just enjoying time with my friends, even on my own sometimes, and eating, drinking wine, and enjoying good things. And even if it could seem not possible, I don't criticize when I go somewhere. I try to be neutral. Unless I go with friends, or I go with some colleagues, or with the owners, to see different restaurants in order to see the competitor, because that's a part of our job, to see what's going on in order to update yourself, mm-hmm. in terms of what's going on in New York. And then, obviously, exercise, meeting friends, people. I try, because we spend many times in between four walls and spending time with your food. At some point, you can lose the inspiration, because at the end of the day, if you all the time stay in the same spot, you don't have any inspiration anymore. So it's good also to meet friends, to make your brain brief, in order to see different things, not just food, but just seeing different things, and and you get inspired. I mean, it's like many painters. All the time when we see a Van Gogh, Picasso, whatever, it's all about what they visited, about their trip, about a girlfriend they met during their life. When you want to create a plate, you get inspired also about friends, or you meet someone from different origins and you go to it at his place and you try something that you didn't know. Or you go on the market, you see new product, and especially for me, because there are different products in the US that, and also habits from the customer that we don't have in France. So I try to also make my mind brief in order to see what's going on out of the box.
And Raphael, last question before we open it to the floor. What would be your recommendation for any future young person out there that wants to become a chef today in this world?
I would say first, listen to your parents. Because it's a very, even if it's changing a lot, it's still right now a very difficult job, I would say, because you have to give a lot of yourself. And when I say a lot of yourself, it's also about the family that you have around. I mean, when you have kids or a wife or whatever, it's not easy all the time to deal family time and work and friends. So It demands a lot of discipline, and discipline also with yourself, because discipline, I think that's very important. You have to be relaxed. I mean, today I look disciplined because I'm stressed to be in front of you, but most of the time I'm very relaxed. So, but discipline with yourself, because you are all the time dealing with food. You are all the time dealing with good things, cheese, I love cheese, pastry, wine, I love wine, food, and if I listen myself on a daily basis, I in the kitchen I have my office behind the pastry, and behind that pastry there are all the time some crème brûlée, you know, that delicious custard cream with the caramel sugar on the top. Obviously, if I don't have the discipline, I'm going to eat at least 3 per day. And it happens, sometimes it happens. And then I have to think, yeah, Raphael, that's 2 hours jogging in the morning. Yeah, that's discipline, because if you can easily let yourself go and enjoying it, actually, because we have a job who asks you to spend a lot of time with the food, so you have, and so because you spend a lot of time on that kitchen, you can't spend a lot of time for yourself. And it means that you can easily get bigger.
Fat.
And I will get bigger at some point anyway. But I try... On the brasserie, there is, and I love burger. On the brasserie, the cafe menu that we have at Le Cirque, we do burger and fries. I love burger, I love fries. And we do that 20, 30 every day. How many times I would like to eat that burger that I serve to that customer with the cheese? With the cheese melting and those crispy fries. Even one, I mean. But when you send 30 burgers, it's already 30 fries, one service. And then there is the dinner service, so it's already 60 fries. And it's 6 days a week. So, I mean, discipline. That's discipline with yourself. And some things that I learn a lot with the British people. That's why I love London. Attitude. because when I was working in Paris, I was executive chef in Paris, and that's why I understood on that time that you can't compare the logical from one country to another. And that's why it's still difficult right now to speak English, because I'm still trying to compare French to British, and it doesn't work. It doesn't work. So when I was in Paris, in France, sometimes we are very, very, I mean, like, I don't know what you say.
Narrow-minded?
What?
Narrow-minded?
Yeah, that's, I can't say that. Like, yeah, what we do is, that's the way it should be. We are the best. So, and
we're very arrogant, maybe also in France.
Yeah, and thanks to have lived a few years in London, because still sometimes people they say, "Oh, Raphaël, you are so arrogant." I say, "Oh my gosh, who was before?" Because, I mean, in London, people they calm me down so many times. But when you are in France, yeah, we are arrogant and we think that everything we do are the best. Because obviously, we are very focused into details. And also, we can explain that because in France, we don't have the diversity that you can find in New York or in London. Of course, there are people from different countries. But the common things that you can find in New York and London is the diversity of people coming from all over the world. And when you are in France, in your kitchen, you mainly work with people from France, and some people from France, mainly from France. But when you are in London, and when I arrived in London after 11 years in Paris, so people, they were looking at me like I was, who was that chef? He's stupid. I was yelling for nothing. I was, because the guy was not putting the point exactly the way I put, I was arguing with the guy. So I was all the time arguing. And I was all the time paying so much attention to unnecessary details that at some point I was about to be on my own in the kitchen. And then I would have done everything on my own. And then I would have done many hours and gray hair, and then you go back home, you want exactly the socks. You want your socks to be fold exactly the same way. And then at some point you say, hold on, Raphaël, you have to adjust your leadership. And from being someone very arrogant and narrow-minded, I was dealing at the Connaught Hotel with people from India, from Australia, from Hungarian, British, Irish, Scottish, French, Spanish, South African. I mean, people from all over the planet. And everything in my kitchen. I think when I was at the Connaught Hotel, I used to have 17 kind of
nationality.
So it means that the first year I was there, I was a crazy, crazy guy. I was not thinking, but for them, they were looking at me. Whoa, dude. And plus, I couldn't speak English that time. So it was even worse. But I was brave. So when I was doing a line on the plate, and because the target was to have at least one Michelin star, and in France, to have stars is consistency, being precise and everything. So when I was doing one line on the plate, my line was like, 36 degrees. So I expected 80 plates, 86 degrees for the line. So, and someone from India or from London or Spanish was doing the line and it was like 95 degrees. And then I was putting the point and the point was not like two inch or 2 centimeters, one to each other. And basically I was yelling and making the plates again and again and again. So for one plate, we were doing 10 times the plates. And And then at some point I sat down and I was reminding one of the guys who told me, Raphael, if you keep thinking with your logical French logical, you will never learn English. And basically I say, yeah, but it should be the same with people from different countries, different cultures, because the way they learn, people when they learn in their country, they learn with their own vision, their own culture, their own logic, their own, and basically my style grow as well, raised. I got more mature, so I adapted my style and I did. And basically, they participate. Those guys, they participated to my own benefit. And because my heart was always going 200 miles an hour, and I was all the time, I say, if I keep going that way, I'm gonna get an heart attack very soon. So I change and I modify. And we had two Michelin stars, so it was a work team, and it worked. So, yeah. So,
wow, what an achievement! Well, without further ado, Raphael, I think we could go on for hours and talk about your experience, which is so rich. But I would love to open up the floor because I'm sure many people have questions here. So, if you don't mind. Please feel free to raise your hands if there's any questions, and Meg will pass on the mic.
How did you get to Le Cirque? Did they approach you, or did you know about the opening?
Alors, I knew Le Cirque because I had the chance to come a few times in New York. And I had the chance to meet people that I'm still in touch now. So Le Cirque, they contacted me when I was at the Connaught Hotel. At the beginning, I was not sure to come because New York was always a dream. I always dreamed to be in New York. But in another hand, I was in a nice routine in London, and plus what we did at the Connaught Hotel was a huge challenge, huge work, and a huge changes for me. So they came the first time, and I was not sure to come to New York, even if it was, I always dreamed to come to New York. And then I decided, if you don't do it now, you will never do it. So I say, let's go, let's make the try. So I decided to meet them. And when I meet them, they brought me in New York, and obviously they asked me to make a testing. So I did a testing for them, and I'm here.
Great.
What would you say to a young aspiring cook who says?
Yeah, I didn't finish that question actually. Yeah.
Well, did you want to finish your question?
No, it was the question. Was pretty much the question.
Yes,
that
you talked about attitude. You talked about discipline.
But then I stopped. I don't know why. I had a blank. First of all, you have to be sure about that. So it means that you have to talk with the right people, because it's true that when you do that job, and especially now with everything that you can see in the media, we see only the nicest part of the job, because if they would have put the bad part of the job, I guess it's not. It wouldn't be on the TV. So they
the sexy.
Yeah, they show the sexy part. And obviously, because they show the sexy part, they are, and it's good because we need people on that field. But some people, they think, wow, that's a cool job. Yeah, it's cool, but you have to think that you're gonna do that job for a few years. And so it's always good to have advices from people who are in the industry and in order to have a proper real idea of the business. Because it's true that when you look at the TV, I mean, it's nice, it's cool, because you become a master chef in few episodes. And it took me years. I mean, it took me years to get there. I mean, I wish I could have done one episode to be a chef and to have my restaurant. Because now that's the fact. Everything goes fast. Even in the education. I mean, I remember when I left school, they say, yeah, you know, before to become a chef, you're gonna be a commis for a long, long time. You're gonna peel potatoes for a long time. And then you say, wow, okay, yes, sir. And he was actually right. I mean, it takes time. And then doing any section and now also when I would say being also, and when I say stable, now because there are so many restaurants all over the place, the people who want to go to that job, they want to do many restaurants. And now what I have, the resume that I have right now, I would say 90% of the resume that I have, they've done 3 months, 6 months, 7 months, 1 year. Wow, that's good. And they do so many places. And the fact is because you do so many places, of course you've seen many places, but you didn't actually learn how to cook, because the when you cook, when you become an accomplished chef, is not about what you have seen the most, is how you feel comfortable doing things, the automatism. Then they ask you some things you don't even need to think about. It's just you do it. And when you have customer who ask you some things that you don't have or you are not ready to make it, you do it. And when people look at you, they say, wow, that guy, it's like, it's naturally. And the only way to have that, to be comfortable in doing things is in working and doing again and again and again. And it's not because you're gonna cook 300 Dover sole the same night that the day after you're gonna do it well. No, the day after you're gonna miss it again. So it takes years. So I would say perseverance, but first to have good advices. First, listen to your parents. If they say don't do it, listen to them and ask the right person. And then from the right person, maybe do some tests, try. Because when you are in that job, you have to do it 100%. So it's better that when you are in, you are 100% and you are sure and you become passionate. Because it happened that you have people and they have been doing that job for 3-4 years. They found it very exciting, but at some point the excitement is down because it's a difficult field. There are many restaurants, but it's not every chef who got, like Daniel Bonu, many restaurants. It's not every chef who are on the TV show. It's not every chef who are on the magazine. So it's very important to know the reality of the field, to speak with people from the field, and then why not to make some training and then when you are in that job, yeah, you have to do it 100%, and then you have to like it because you're gonna work that job for a long time, so. But I all the time when I have people, new chefs who arrive in the kitchen, I try to make them interested about, yeah, big piece of meat, because now everything is small portion, everything is already ready. So we try to bring the whole lamb, the whole pork, the whole fish, the or to make yourself the charcuterie, like the black pudding, or to make how to make a sausage, even if it's old school, trying to show them that to buy a sausage, yeah, it's so common, you buy the sausage, but to make it, I mean, it's actually more complicated than that. So like that's why I say to Camille that I will be there at 5:30. I arrive at almost 6. I was doing this afternoon Lièvre à la Royale. Alors, de lièvre, c'est de hare, which is a kind of wild rabbit, so which is a old school French dish. But I love that dish because it's old school, because it's a part of the history of the culinary culinary repertory, qui est classique.
Repertoire.
And basically, I had a few chefs, they've never seen that before, so they saw me to have the whole rabbit, and then you remove all the bones, you have the whole piece, and then you marinated it, and then and they saw it that it takes time to make it. Yeah, it takes 2 days. So it means that before to put on the plates, it's 2 days of work. And so I try on my side to make them in. To interest them on that way, to explain them that now it's easy, you can buy everything already portioned, already on fillet, already clean, but actually that's the whole piece, and it's difficult for myself to explain how to make the people to make my job, because For my side, I love that job. I was attracted to that job because of the excitement of the service, and because I was I'm a glutton and I love food, and the blend of everything made me decide to do that job. But I have to say that during my during that process, it happened that sometimes I was like, wow. And you have to strongly believe that what you do is the right choice. So, and it's still now. Sometimes when you have the critics, when sometimes you know when what you do, you do it with your heart, and when you have a customer who is unhappy and he tell you that he's unhappy, you are like, yeah, sometimes he can hurt you, definitely.
Raphael, I see that time is flying, and I'm sure a lot of people have more questions. So I think that the best will be for us to continue the questions during the reception, if you agree. And but thank you again so much. It's been very, very informative. It's been a delight. We really feel the passion through your words and what you're saying. So we're really thrilled, and we love to pursue with wine and cheese.
Yeah, definitely.
So I would like, just before you all move, I would just like to express our thanks, first of all, to Camille for asking the questions and indeed inviting Raphael in the first place. Raphael, it has been a great pleasure and an honor to have you here this evening. You have been a wonderful part of our Artisan series, and I can't tell you how interesting it was to have this background look, and for you to take time away from your really busy schedule to give us a sort of an overview of what the life of an executive chef is. We are so appreciative, and I think if we've just given him another round of applause, right? And I also feel we should all head for Le Cirque right now. we happen to have a couple of Raphael's favorite foods. We have wine and cheese, which I hope you will stay for. Unfortunately, we don't have chips or French fries, but but anyway, we would like to, on behalf of the General Society, we would like to present you with this memento of the evening, a citation, which we will
as a memory of us. We would also like to, I know you're very busy, but we would like you to give you honorary lifetime membership of this library. Yeah. Nice.
Thank you very much.
And finally, another little memento of the evening.
Thank you.
Right. So I want to thank our speakers again. I want to thank you for coming. I knew it was a very unpleasant, cold night, and thank you for braving the cold. And we'll look forward to seeing you at future Artisan Lectures. Thank you so much.